presence. Come on, do you feel it? Hallelujah. Let's sing it.
Good morning, Acts family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We're so grateful you've joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and follow us on social media at Acts Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to actsantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. And you can also give by mail and send it in a P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. Now today is communion, so don't forget to grab any elements you may need if you would like to participate with us. And this week's verse is Jeremiah 33:6, which says, I will heal my people and let them enjoy abundant peace and security. Friends, we often search for healing, but God promises us strength. We use our faith to heal and continue on the path that God has always had planned for us. And remember, here at Acts, we love you and we're here for you, and we want to pray for you, so send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
Good morning. We're going to share a story with you this morning. Be healed.
Got a story to tell you about some things that I've been through, but I'm what went wrong, but I'm here. Oh, I'm here.
Well, hello, friends. I'm wondering if you ever met somebody that just seems to be a know-it-all, or a group of people that they know right and wrong, but they seem to want to persuade everybody that they're right and they want us to do it their way only. Well, when people do that, there's something going on the inside of that person. A few weeks ago, I spoke about how the heart can be deceitful. Well, sometimes we sell ourselves on an idea or an ideology or a concept only to find out later it's not genuine, it's not true. But we keep pressing because of the pride that we have. We don't want to admit that we're wrong, or we have genuinely forgotten the truth. And so we come to this story in the scriptures in the book of Matthew in a moment that I'm going to bring to your attention. But you see, God had already set the rules of life up through Moses, through the Mosaic covenant. And then, of course, he changed some things along the way. But nonetheless, there's a group of leaders in Israel that's supposed to lead the people according to the law. But they find out at different times that the law wasn't really in their favor. So therefore, they began to persuade the people as if they were the ones to govern the people, that what they wanted to do was God's principles. Turned out wasn't true. So what's wrong with people that live that way? People that have sold themselves on the concept that they're just right about life and everybody else needs to do life their way. There's something going on in that person. Now, this group of people Jesus is having this conflict with are called Pharisees. They were leaders of the people of Israel in that day. So Jesus comes into this conflict with them, and we see this in Matthew 23, and we also see it Matthew 24, it carries on. But here, Jesus says something to these people in Matthew 23, these so-called leaders. He says in 23, 25 through 26, "Woe to you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites," he calls them, "for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee," he says, "first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside also may be clean." So there's something that's taking place here that needs to be addressed. So I think God wants to heal us from the inside out. When we're living that way, we can't seem to muster up what it takes to change on the outside. So the Lord comes along and he shares with us that clean up the inside, that thing going on in your heart right now, get that straight, and then work on that outside. But these people had turned that process around. They clean the outside and ignore the inside. We see that a lot today. Jesus personally condemns the behavior of the Pharisees. He saw these men were consumed with external appearances and rituals, but not with the internal conditions of their hearts. They cleaned their outside. They walked around with great pride, with rich clothing, with tassels hanging on their clothing. But on the inside, they were full of greed and indulgence. And this self-indulgence that they were consumed with was taking over their life. And they had approached Jesus with this concept, to which he then challenged them immediately. So we'll take a look at that, because oftentimes we have friends and others that we know that are leaders, even leaders of our nation, that need some inner healing before they just clean themselves up on the outside and present themselves to us as great leaders, and they'll call themselves that. They're self-consumed, and God is opposed to that kind of behavior. So at the deepest level, we all live by beliefs that we hold in our unconscious. Because they are unconscious, we are not always aware of them. These beliefs guide our behavior, however, automatically, without our even thinking about it. It's just the ideology that we've followed for so long, it becomes automatically a part of us. When these beliefs are negative or they're self-condemning, then our behavior is often self-destructive. Being aware of these unconscious beliefs is the best way to effectively change our external behavior in a way that will last. So we need to look on the inside. What are some of these unconscious beliefs that we might have, or that these brethren had in that day? In verse 25 of our text, he says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you can clean the inside of the cup and the plate, but you can clean the outside, rather, of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence." This name that he refers to, these Pharisees, it means one that's separated for a life of purity. So here they were giving this outward appearance that they were living a pure life, but inside they were not as pure, certainly not in their intentions about God's people. Pharisees are difficult to describe. Three ancient sources, for instance, Josephus, the New Testament, and the rabbinic literature that we have available to us to read today, have limited information, which offers a rather difficult time for us to interpret what a Pharisee really is. But scholars have pictured the Pharisees as a sect within Judaism, a powerful religious leadership group. They also call them a political leadership group, a learned scholarly group, a lay movement in competition with the priesthood. That's the significant part. It's a group of know-nothings that pretend that they know everything and they want everybody to follow them. But Jesus calls them hypocrites because of their behavior, because of their refusal to clean up the inside. The American political system also seemed to have a group of that who feel that they know the best for all the people. Yeah, they hold unconscious beliefs that people who do not hold their values are evil and need to be somehow eliminated from American society. They don't care how offensive they are, but their unconscious beliefs are controlling them. They just think that they're doing right, and they want everybody to follow them. Jesus says that these Pharisees do not connect their beliefs with their behavior. That's what he's saying. If they could really see how they are behaving, they would understand that that belief system they're presenting to us is unconscious. It's something deep within their soul. So they have an unconscious belief which dictates that behavior. Look at Matthew 23, verses 2 and 3. "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat." See, they sit high. They're the ones that want to tell everybody else what to believe and what to do. "Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do." That's what they're saying to us. "But do not," he says, "do according to their own works, for they say and do not do." They're the ones that are busy running their mouths. They're telling us what we should do, but they themselves don't do it. Jesus calls them hypocrites. this is a tough assignment for people, because that requires the person that's behaving that way, that's wrapped up in their unconscious beliefs, to change. Let me see if I can get off track for a second to give you an illustration of that. I grew up, and I've told you this many times, in a segregated South. Well, I find it interesting that the public restrooms in the segregated South, at the bus station or service station or any place in the theater, had signs on them, color and white, as if anybody going into either of those rooms was going to do something different than the other party did. They did the same thing. The same thing that came out of them also came out of others. There was no difference. But these signs were up because somebody had this unconscious belief that some group, one of these groups, was lesser than the other. So they treated us differently. This is true in life. You meet people right now today, you're on your walk on a regular day, your early morning walk, and you say good morning, they say nothing, just keep their head straight ahead and walk as if they didn't hear you or didn't see you. People are like that, but that's not God's order. That's not the way God ordained life to be in the world that we live in today. But the world is corrupt and full of these Pharisee-type people. In Luke 11 and 39 and 40, we hear these words, "Now you Pharisees make the outside of the cup and dish clean, but your inward part is full of greed and wickedness. Foolish ones, did not he who made the outside make the inside also?" What a question. What a question to be asked. That kind of levels the playing field. So you would ask, what are these unconscionable behaviors that are going on in this time that Jesus was speaking with this group? Jesus calls the leaders out while pointing out their unconscionable behavior. These behaviors are acts without a God consciousness. And we know a lot of people today that are aspiring to be leaders of our country, who are acting and behaving without a God conscious. Oh, they go to church, they say, and they hear the same words that are written in the scriptures that you and I hear in our churches. But are they living those things? Is there something inside of them, this unconscious belief system, that say they have to be different than any other Christian? And that, by the way, all other Christians and everybody else in the world have to be as they are. I've told you this story also before, but I'll never forget it as long as I live. When we would go to church in that segregated South, because of the color of our skin, we had to sit in the back pews. Three pews were reserved in the back of the church for us. Anybody else could sit anyplace else. When we went up to receive communion from the priests, we had to receive the communion last. See, that's that whole idea of these Pharisees pretending to be members of the priesthood. They want to tell the people of God how they should be living and what should be normal. Friends, that's just not so. You know, some of these unconscionable beliefs that these people of the day that Jesus was speaking with them had, that was demonstrated, we find in Matthew 23, starting at verse 4 and reading down through verse 15. I won't read the whole section to you, but let me point out some of these unconscionable behaviors. First of all, he says in verse 4, they create hard work for others to do. Verse 5, they only work to be seen. How about that? Verse 6, they love the best seats. Verse 7, they love title recognition. They want you to recognize their title. Verse 13, but they do not witness. They don't share the truth with anybody else. Matter of fact, they share nothing with anyone else. They're selfish. They, in verse 14, take advantage of the widows. in verse 15, they are a bad influence on the people that they win. In other words, the people that they bring under their belief system, they are terrible to those people. You've seen examples of that in our modern day. Someone spoke bad about another member of their party, and then all of a sudden they're kissing the ring of that member that spoke bad about them. Yeah. We have this going on in our society today, and here it is alive in the Holy Scriptures for us to read. No wonder we don't agree with it, because the Lord had the same kind of encounters when he was on the earth. But he called them out. He spoke the truth. You see, this behavior that's being displayed here, this unconscionable behavior, models some of our Christian brothers and sisters who are caught up in the political climate of our culture today. Religious leaders are pushing the unconscionable agenda, for instance, of the Christian nationalism or white nationalism movement that's going on in America today. Shame on you for pushing these things onto people, the people of God and others. And shame on you thinking that you are right and proclaiming your righteousness when you don't know what righteousness is. But we see that going on, friends. I'm not chiding anybody that's listening to me. That's not my goal here today. My goal here today is to show you that this behavior is not uncommon to man. These unconscious beliefs that men have grown up with are things that have been shared with us as children. Therefore, it grows up in the fiber of our being. Prejudice doesn't start just because you met someone of a different culture. Prejudice started around the dinner table talking about the people of a different culture. And it started with our grandparents and their parents. It started way before you got here. It's been around. Well, Jesus is telling the people there was a time on this earth when Moses was given the truth of God's word that people were obedient to that truth. Now, there were some that weren't. And now he was telling them in that time that he was speaking in this Matthew text, they weren't obedient at that time. And he called them out for it. Friends, we have to be careful what we fall under, who we believe in as a legitimate ruler of God's people. God is making it clear in Matthew 23 and verse 25. Again, I'll repeat. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you cleanse the outside of the cup and dish, but the inside are full of extortion and self-indulgence." Greed, he calls it. The word hypocrites that he used here is the same word used for actors in a play. In other words, what's he saying? They're acting out. They're pretending to be something they're not. And it's okay for you to see that in a person. In many leaders, we see that. In churches, we see that in leadership. There are people acting. They're hypocrites. They know the truth, but they're not obeying the truth. They're not performing the truth. They're acting. They're make-believing that what I tell you to do is better than what God has told you to do. No, friends. God calls them out. This is the person acting out something other than who they really are. They're pretentious. They're pretending to be what they are not. They're conflicted on the inside. They themselves personally are conflicted. Their unconscious beliefs dictates their outward behavior. We know people like that, don't you? I do. And I know you're so concerned about how I'm preaching today because it's just a little bit out of the ordinary. No, what I want to do is bring to your consciousness, you that is not being truthful, that you need to be truthful. And I want to make the others aware that are falling under your kind of cultic behavior. You have mesmerized them with your ideas and your ideology, that they're falling for that game now. And I'm trying to warn them, don't fall for every game you hear. Don't. Pray Ask the Lord, ask the Holy Spirit to give you discernment. And just because a person says something, if you have a record of what they have done when they were leading before, then you already know what they're going to do. You know what's going to happen. I like what President Obama said the other day in his speech. He said that, you know, the sequel is oftentimes worse than the first run of that act. So be careful. That's really what's happening here. But now there is something else that can happen, by the way, that would certainly clear this up for us. It would, if we just get it, it would really clear it up for us. Watch this. Matthew 23 and 27. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and are unclean. Now, I want to bring something else. You know, I grew up in Louisiana. So in Louisiana, especially in the New Orleans area of Louisiana, they're down below sea level. So they didn't bury people in the ground. They put their tombs they buried people on top of the ground and built tombs around them. If you ever go to New Orleans, they have tours of the cemeteries. They're just sparklingly beautiful because all the tombs are painted with whitewash. They're all white. You just look through it. My God, it's just a beautiful place. But if you open a tomb, there's nothing in there but dead men's bones. Death is in there. And that's what Jesus is fundamentally saying, that these individuals, these Pharisees, these scribes, these so-called leaders of the people, that's what their lives are. They appear to be one thing, but they're nothing but evil on the inside. It's okay to say amen there. That's hard. That's hard to hear. But it's the truth. But then what's the correct behavior? Glad you asked that. Let's move on to something a little bit better anyways. In Matthew 23 and 12, Jesus says, whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. To humble yourself offers the reward that God will exalt you. If you just humble yourself, if these leaders who have all these terrible things they want to do to people would just humble themselves, God will exalt them. You don't have to exalt yourself. You don't have to lift yourself up above anyone else. You don't have to sit in Moses' seat. You don't have to self-lift yourself. If you just clean yourself up on the inside, the Lord will exalt you. He'll lift you up on the outside. He'll let people know who you really are. In Luke chapter 11 and verse 41, Jesus says, but rather give alms of such things as you have, then indeed all things are clean to you. In other words, he's saying, don't offer to the people something that you don't have to offer. Offer them what you know you have to offer. You see, when you do that, the cleanliness of your offer comes through because you can't offer people what you don't have. Don't make promises you can't keep. Stop pretending and just be who you are. Act out what you believe on the inside, not these unconscious beliefs that you have, but the genuine, true beliefs. You see, healing for your behavior must start from the inside, and then it comes out. Clean up the inside. Thinking and your outside behavior is going to match up to who you say you are. I guess another way of saying that is we could cry out to the Lord, Lord, heal our land. Heal it, Lord, from the inside out. Search me, Lord, and see what's in my heart. Let me know what's in my heart. Allow me to be genuine. The Apostle Paul says in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, and this is a very familiar passage of scripture. It's one that I use quite often. He says, if you then who were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God, set your whole mind, he says, on things above and not on the things of this earth. Don't be so concerned about who's going to bow down to you on the earth. Set your whole mind, all of your thinking. Clean up that unconscious thinking you're having. Put your complete mind on the things above, where Christ is seated, not on the things of this earth. And by the way, the things of this earth, the power, that's what people are seeking in these leadership roles often. And that power, by the way, is earthly. It goes away after a while. You only have a term at it, and then it goes away. Well, what happens is the Lord says, if you just put your mind on things above where I am, you'll see that the end of it all is that if you're true to who God has called you to be, in the end, you're going to be with Him. And He's going to give you a reward in heaven that will never tarnish, that'll never rust away, that'll never be forgotten, because He will focus on you and not on what you don't have that you wish you had. So what's our learning outcome here? I think that the lasting change is certainly something that will take place, but it takes place from the inside out. I've said this to you before, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So if we just focus on what is in the heart, truly in the heart, and we get that heart cleaned up, then that outside behavior will modify. It'll also become clean. When people see you, they'll see Christ. But now when they see you, they have to listen carefully, because your inside is different than the outside. The outside is beautiful. You dress well, you speak well, but the inside, your heart is messed up. So the word here for all of us is that Jesus said it best in Matthew 23 and 6. He says, "Blind Pharisees, first, cleanse the inside of the cup and the dish, that the outside of them may then be clean." So what's the imperative? I always like to bring up the imperatives of the text, because those are the things that tell us it's possible for you to do it. We look at an individual that's always been rotten on the inside and continue to be rotten on the outside. They'll never change. That's not true. You shouldn't be down on yourself and say, "I'll never change. I'm so far in now, I can never get out." No, you can change. You can change, because the imperative is there. The mood of possibilities. He says, first, cleanse the inside. And by the way, a complement to that imperative is that it's also, he offers us the middle voice. And I've told you before, what the middle voice is means that's for your benefit. That's not for anybody else's benefit. So the Lord is not calling on these liars, these hypocrites, these Pharisees, these scribes. He's not calling on you to change for other people. He's calling on you to change for your own benefit. When you change for your benefit, it reflects who God is and how powerful God is, not how powerful you are. He wants you to humble yourself. And when he speaks of humble, he's talking about like the Nile River. In certain seasons, you see, the Nile River was at a very low point. It was low. It was humble. It wasn't high. You could only do so much on the Nile at that point. He's saying, be like the Nile River. Run low. He'll raise you up in the season that he wants you to be lifted up. We have to understand that. The Lord wants to lift you up, but he wants you to do something. Humble yourself. Get low. He'll raise you up in the right season for you. Anyways, look, you can't say that you are a Christian if you do not change, or if you don't want to change. How can you come out and say you're a Christian? I'm a Christian on the inside, but I don't represent that change of behavior on the outside. Who's going to follow you with that statement? But that's the reality of many people, and we need to change that. I like what the psalmist said in Psalms 51 and 10. The psalmist, King David, he speaks out to the Lord. He cries out, "Creating me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." He's basically saying, I've made my mistakes. I've done some things that weren't right. But Lord, you created me a clean heart. You, O God, renew a steadfast, a right spirit within me. have your Holy Spirit to speak to me. That's what he's saying. Now, Fred Hammond wrote a song that I dare say suits the case for today. He said, "Give me a clean heart to see you like I should. Hey," he says, "to walk the path that's right, to do the things that you would give me a clean heart, and I'll serve you, nobody but you." In that second verse, he says, "Give me a clean heart to loose that double mind that I have, to believe you when you tell me everything will be just fine. Just lay your hands on me, Lord, and I'll be brand new." That's what God wants to do. He wants to lay his hand on you, on any person that wants to lead the peoples with this unconscious belief on the inside. They want to do it in the name of Christianity. They want to do it in the powerful name of our Lord and Savior. You can't do that. You must call on God to give you that clean heart. And for some people who don't know the Lord at all, the scripture says if you would confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. God wants to save people, and he wants to save people to listen to the voice of his word that he brings to us in multiple ways. He says, "Lo, I come in the volume of the book." Friends, if it's not out of this book, we should not be trying to do it. That's what he's telling us. And then on a day like today, this is a Sunday where in our church we have communion. We come together to celebrate the death, burial, and most importantly, the resurrection of our Lord. He told his disciples on that night before going to the cross, he said to them clearly on that evening, he said, "As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." There's so much we need to do in the remembrance of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We need to remember what he's asked of us. We need to remind others about what he's asked of us. So today, let me pray and let's enjoy communion together. Just a time with the Lord. Come in close to him. Get your elements and ask the Lord to, as Fred Hammond would sing it, give you a clean heart to lose your double-mindedness that you have. Ask him to clean that away, your unconscious belief system that you're caught up in. Return to what Moses has taught us in his word, that we're to do according to the word of God. Live a way that we'll just be fine. We'll be okay. Because if we honor him, he's going to also honor his legacy. He is going to bring us before him one day. And that's where the judgment will take place. But we will, as believers, forever be in the presence of the Lord. Oh, how precious is that thought. Lord, we come with the bread that represents your body. We ask that you bless it as you did that night, broke it and gave it to your disciples, and you said to them all, "Let us take and eat." Then, Lord, you took that cup of the fruit of the vine that represented your blood that was shed for the freedom of all mankind to erase sin forever. May we drink together. God bless you, friends. God.
kingdom come, let your will be done, let your glory fall on your daughters and sons. God, hear us from heaven, send us your presence, we need you, Lord.